in Nepal. It actually starts about 7:30 at night at Raleigh-Durham Airport, where we catch an American Airlines flight to London Gatwick. After about 8 hours flying across the Atlantic, we landed about 7:30 a.m. in London, took the London Gatwick Express train to downtown London, and proceeded to see the sights, which included the changing of the guards here. Keep a close eye out for Alistair Cook's younger first cousins here. English female Bobby be called a Bobette, or is that too close to Bobbit for comfort?
I can gangway clear, please. I can gangway clear.
Thank you.
later that flight, we came to realize that the King of Nepal was aboard our aircraft. He boarded in London, England, and security was kind of amazing. So we took this shot of him landing in Kathmandu, being greeted by his royal guard, I guess. What we found interesting was everybody looked like they had just gotten out of bed with their pajamas on and had thrown this gray sport coat on over it. You'd think they'd have some better idea of high fashion in Kathmandu, but I don't know. When in Nepal, do as the Nepalese do. There's a considerable difference between the international airport and the domestic airport. In just a second, you will see our adventures a couple of days later in the domestic airport as we attempted to fly from Kathmandu to Pokhara. We were, however, turned back by foul weather and had to take alternative transport.
In front of me, dear. Walk in front of me, dear. Domestic terminal, complete with up-to-the-date security measures. Modern restroom facilities. Incredibly interesting people. I'm really going more for the lady in pink than anything else. And I want to come around here.
How is it that Nancy seems to know every time I even think about looking at another woman?
On our way to Pokhara again! Second try!
Load the airplane, unload the airplane. Does this look familiar? If it does, it's the same airport we were hoping to leave, but in a different fashion.
Planes, trains, automobiles, we're gonna do it all.
Here we go.
This is the put-in of the Seti River. It was running very high. We had three or four of the folks do sit-on tops, but Nancy only paddled for about a day and a half because of the size of the water and the squirrelies. So what you're going to be subjected to now is a whole lot of shots of Joe and the raft running the rapids.
Going into the eddy. I'm going to climb the two duckies getting into the eddy. It up for the camera. That's my Joe. Wait till I tell him the battery went dead.
What's that?
I said, wait till I tell him the battery went dead. He's having it up for nothing. Yep, Joe, we got ya. Preparations for the big run. Ross gonna tackle it in the sit down. Sit on top. And some hooking and hollering. So slopes on the right. Rafts doing a great job. There's a 10th or 11th river slip. Yep, a little crack in the hole. Thumbs up, rolling good. And then the bulk of it again after having worked his way halfway back up the rapid. Feel the paddle swirl at the end. Got some fishermen here fixing up their nets. Showing the one fella how to do it. So he's doing a probe. We stopped to scout the first rapid. Little brother, this is little brother, I can't wait to see big brother. Joe's doing some 360s in the hole, he's going to run the rapid first. And we're all going to follow him down. He's George. He's going to run Big Brother first.
He's got some movement. He's not straightforward. He's got some rocks that the current is going towards.
I'm going to lose him going around the bend here, and that's where the big hole is. We'll keep him inside as long as we can. Right side.
Is that pulled around just enough to slide on into the heading. Maybe it's going to be high.
And Miss Maria's round up the there goes Joe. Again, we'll lose it when it gets behind the rock, but I'll just try to pick him up on the other side. And he's come through just fine.
That was little brother upstream. This is Big Brother down here. There's our brain trust. Yes, sirree, even scouting is amazing. Here's Nancy braving life and limb. Fording. An incredibly deep stream. Of course, the idea that kids about 4 years old are out here swimming in it, that's probably about waist deep. Stand up now, dear. Oh, God, was that dangerous. My God, you made it. Say something, dear. Say something. And Gabriella walking back up to a long walk. This is one of those scout for an hour takes 60 seconds to run kind of rapids. Pretty exciting. I don't know what in the hell class it is, but At least it's a narrow and constricted passage anyway. Heroine. There she is, still walking back upstream. She's one of the longest scouts in the northern hemisphere, I think. But Nancy's trooping on up. Boy, look at that butt. Isn't that a great butt? Okay, checking back in on the best butt in the northern hemisphere. Getting tighter with every step that it takes. There we go. She is almost back to the group. All right, looking good. They'll be on their way anytime now. There she is. Nancy finally joins the intrepid little group. I don't know what they're thinking about. Last I knew, Nick was kind of going to come down the left-hand side of the orange rock here, but after watching this kayak, there's going to be going down the gut. We're going to have to wait to see. Okay, and here comes the crew of the intrepid Nick now. Nick at night. The question is he going for the gusto route down the right? Or is he going to go over here on the left? Let's see what Nick has in store for the crew of the intrepid. Looks like it's going to be a left-hand run here. Yeah. The hearts in the paddle raft are beating a little slower now. Yeah, yeah. Good conservative line this early in the trip. Pretty much taking the same line the oar boat did. Some help waiting in case anybody needs it. Probably going to wind up making a rock eddy or two on the way through here. Let's see. It's a little lighter than the oar boat. Well, maybe not. They got all these bodies in it. Pivot here, maybe. Just to make sure it doesn't get away to the right. I see what he's doing. Okay, that was a little Nepali rock bounce there. The raft is free. Swinging to the right. Not too far right. Oh, look at that. All in unison, back paddle. Beautiful. Use the line as a pivot. Make sure the boat doesn't get away to the right. Nice. Smart plan. Well done.
Here we are in camp. Night four. Morning too, I should say. Nancy! Whoop. That's right, Carolyn, your mommy's going rock climbing. Thank you.
That's right, Buckaroos. You guessed it. The name of the rapid is the Jaws of Death.
No problem.
is our first stop on day three. Stopping to scout a rapid. Got this just beautiful little village here. The little boy actually asked me if they took pictures. He said, yo, yo, photo, photo, me, me. This is our first big rapid I found. They threw a little religion rapid. It's called Seti Benny. And we know that Seti means white, and we can't seem to locate anyone who can tell us what Benny means. We just concluded this climb and watching the kayaks come through does get a little close. It's a great bowl of going to the
I apologize for that, and I'm sure it is for that, and I'm sure that did affect everybody, but I just couldn't help it. The devil made me do it. A day or so later, we came to this abandoned palace. It's a place called Ranigat. It kind of felt like being at the Nepalese equivalent of Tara in Atlanta. It's a number of different stories in the guidebook as to how it was built and then later as to why it was abandoned. The interesting thing that I found is that the locals have scavenged almost everything they possibly could for building materials except for the temples, as you'll see in the pictures coming up.
Hey, how steep is it?
It's about that steep. God, that's a shot too. Watch it.
Beautiful, the stone is.
Be cool.
Were you filming that?
That's the temple. I think that's the home of the goddess or god of destruction.
And I think this was actually about 60 years that this happened. And he was so upset when his wife died, he basically just left and just chased everybody out of the palace and just abandoned the palace. He just cruised there. And about 40 years later, a real brave man came in to the valley and conquered all of the valleys.
The intrepid Joe, ledge walking on the palace, second story, onto the balcony.
Romeo, Romeo, wait a minute, Juliet, Juliet.
Morning of day five minutes into the trip, and we're looking at this raft. It's called Walking the Dark. I'm saying it'll be the most significant one of the day.
comes the crew of the SS Intrepid now. Oh, look at how calm they look.
Last day at the takeout. Goes ferrying across. Had a great day in the river. Smile for the camera.
Ah, Kali was kind. All praise to Kali.
Woo!
Final morning in Pokhara. Nancy got up very early, and we were very, very fortunate in that we had a beautiful sunrise over Pokhara in the morning, which then illuminated the Himalayas. We had a nice rain the night before, and it cleared the sky, and so this was really a very big treat in the spring to be able to see the Himalayas like this over Pokhara. There's a little bit of a mist, but in general, we get a really good look at them. We're looking at the Annapurna Range in Machu Picchu. Nancy didn't do a lot of narrating at this time, so I'll go ahead and I'll provide it as it comes by. We think this is Machu Picchu there. It's also called the fishtail. And these are probably the Annapurnas coming up now. This was quite a treat because normally in the spring, the clouds and the dust in the air obscure the mountains from Pokhara. And as you can see, it's a pretty impressive sight. Pokhara is about 2,000, 2,500 feet in altitude. And these mountains rise 25, 26, 27,000 feet in the background. Nancy suits directly into the sun here to get the sunrise coming up. This is the early morning milk queue in Pokhara. We saw these wherever we went throughout Nepal. The only queuing we saw actually was for milk. That was a little bit interesting. I guess it's fresh every morning. Nancy pulls back here and now gets a shot of some of the lakes that are around Pokhara. City of Kathmandu in the Kathmandu Valley is famous for its temples and its ancient shrines. Pokhara is a newer city built in the foot of the Himalayas and is famous for the lakes and the views of the Himalayas. We left Pokhara later on that day aboard an aircraft. We were able to take an aircraft from Pokhara back to Kathmandu. That's the reverse of the flight we wanted to take from Kathmandu to Pokhara, but we were very lucky. This was a very clear day, a beautiful day, and we got to take the flight. And what you'll see during the flight is a lot of aerial shots from the airplane, which came out reasonably well, which show a lot of the terrain of Nepal. I tried to take some of the shots of the Himalayas out the window. They didn't come out as well as I'd hoped they would. And especially notice the beautiful terracing that goes on in the agricultural lands of Nepal. So we got off the ground okay. As we landed in Kathmandu, we happened to catch sight of the temple, the Buddhist temple, the Tibetan Buddhist temple at the Bodanath. And lo and behold, they were having a Buddhist ceremony there. So Nancy and I, as soon as we landed, grabbed a taxi cab and went over to the temple at Bodanath for the Buddhist ceremony. As soon as the flight is over with, you will start to hear the cacophony and the sounds, and then eventually the sights and the sounds of a Tibetan Buddhist ceremony at the temple at Bodanath. That's the sight we'd like to leave you with. In just a second here, I think you'll see some of the pretty terracing that takes place in the in Nepal. The final sequence will be a close-up of what many people have called the compassionate eyes of Buddha. And many of the Buddhist temples, the Tibetan Buddhist temples in Kathmandu, have these eyes that face out on all four sides. Some people refer to them as the wisdom eye. I prefer to think of this as the compassionate eyes of Buddha. I was quite taken with them. There's something kind of spiritual and otherworldly about them. So sit back and enjoy, if you can, the cacophony and the sounds and the sights of the Tibetan Buddhist ceremony at Bodanath. We only wish we could bring back the smells and the feel. It was quite a sensory, sensual, and spiritual experience.
Follow me.
Yeah.